Hi everyone, I am Ramis Soss, a ThingPark's product manager and RF specialist at Actility, and I'm glad to present you the main guidelines of LoRaWAN RF planning and how ThingPark network tools can help you easily do this RF planning, starting from the design phase till the validation phase in the field. Here I will focus on the RF planning methodology for outdoor macro LoRaWAN gateways installed on high points, such as rooftops or mounted on towers, but for indoor design, the methodology remains very similar to outdoor gateways, but the planning tools are different. Before digging into the details, let's first set the expectations of such RF planning exercise. In other words, why should LoRaWAN network deployment engineers care about RF planning? The first objective is to estimate the RF coverage range offered by a LoRaWAN gateway. Such coverage depends on your design criteria. For instance, the gateway shall offer a larger coverage to outdoor devices over SF12 compared to indoor devices using SF9. And then, after assessing the coverage of a single gateway, you would need to estimate how many gateways are required to cover the area of interest. And this is typically required at pre-sales stage to establish a bill of quantity and compute your total cost of ownership. And then, you would need to choose the optimal placement for your gateways, relying on RF simulation tools to predict the coverage provided by your future gateways before proceeding to the rollout phase. Then, after installing your gateways, you would need to assess the effective RF coverage provided by your gateway fleet, this time relying on field measurements rather than prediction studies. And doing RF planning also helps you determine the potential coverage gaps in your existing network, correlating them with quality of service problems reported by operational teams. This assessment allows you to decide whether gateway densification is required and where to put your new gateways. Last but not the least, besides coverage assessment, doing RF planning allows you to estimate the radio capacity offered by your gateways by assessing the expected density of your devices according to the mix of traffic profiles you want to serve in your network. Now that we have set the scope, the next question would be, how to do a serious RF planning? One would say, LoRa RF planning is quite simple. I can easily derive the expected path loss by subtracting the receiver sensitivity from the radiated power of the transmitter. Then I can convert this path loss into cell range by using a propagation model that is appropriate for the sub-gigahertz propagation. Is the exercise really that simple? From my 18 years of experience in RF planning, I can definitely answer nope. And I will explain you why in the coming slides. A crucial step in any serious RF planning is to compute the link budget in both uplink and downlink directions. And in each direction, the link budget shall compute the maximum allowable path loss, taking into account the transmit power, the receiver sensitivity, the different gains and losses, as well as the additional design margins. Then, the link having the smaller MAPL becomes the limiting link, and its MAPL dictates the maximum allowed distance between the transmitter and the receiver through the adequate propagation model. And the gains consist mainly of the transmission and receiver antenna gains, plus the coverage overlapping gain offered by macro diversity. The losses are essentially caused by the gateway's cable and connector losses. And then the design margins consist of additional losses deducted from the total path loss in order to model some specific RF phenomena, such as the fading effect and in-building penetration. In other words, directly converting the total path loss into distance is not correct. Only part of the total path loss can be used to estimate the maximum cell range, and this part is the MAPL. Let's now take a glance at the different design margins required to derive a realistic MAPL. The first one is the small-scale shadowing margin, which is caused by the fast fading effects. So the receiver sensitivity provided by the chip manufacturer is valid for AWGN static channel conditions. However, in reality, the channel conditions are never static, making the RF signal experience large and abrupt fluctuations over time, even when both the transmitter and the receiver are not moving. The different copies of the signal arriving at the receiver from different multipasses sometimes combine constructively and other times destructively, as you can see from the blue curve here. You may try to measure it by yourself If you observe the received signal strength over 20 or 30 uplink packets at a stationary location from a single gateway, you will roughly see fluctuation of plus or minus 10 dB around the average signal strength. This fast feeding effect follows a relay distribution for non-line of sight propagation, and therefore, a margin should be accounted on top of the AWGN sensitivity values to account for small-scale relay feeding. This margin depends on the target packet error rate and the number of repetitions of each packet. The good news is that the overlapping between several gateways allows mitigating part of this fast feeding effect for uplink paths. Take the example of the macro diversity of 2, where uplink packets are received by 2 gateways. So a fading hole for gateway A would be typically compensated by gateway B and vice versa. Similar positive effect happens with uplink repetitions, offering both time and frequency diversity to mitigate the fast fading effects. Another propagation phenomenon is about the shadowing effect. So empirical propagation models predict an average path loss versus distance, and typically these models are calibrated in a way to have the average error versus field measurement as close as possible to zero. And then each propagation model is associated with a standard deviation representing the path loss variation with respect to the average predicted value. This variation is caused by shadowing effects due to obstacles, buildings, trees, and so on. And typical standard deviation of most propagation models is around 8 dB. Therefore, unless an additional margin is considered in the RF planning, the predicted path loss derived by the propagation model at a given distance shall be valid with only 50% probability, since it's an average prediction. And to guarantee higher coverage probability, like 95%, you must add a large-scale shadowing margin. Let's now tackle the in-building penetration losses, which are typically considered by additional margins on top of outdoor path loss. So different penetration levels require different margins. For example, for indoor daylight, or what we also typically call light indoor in, or indoor first wall, we typically add 11 to 18 dB on top of the outdoor path loss, depending on the morphology. And for deep indoor, you can typically consider 5 dB on top of the indoor daylight losses, but the exact values typically depend on the wall material. And for basement, like for metering applications, consider 10 dB extra losses on top of the deep indoor penetration. But here again, the exact values depend on the building material, the floor-to-floor isolation, and the number of underground levels to cover. The fourth design margin I would like to tackle is the interference margin. So as said previously, the receiver sensitivities consider AWGN channel conditions. Hence, they only include the effect of thermal noise, which is typically around negative 120 dBm for LoRaWAN gateways. However, in reality, the overall noise floor is potentially increased above the thermal noise due to the interference effect. Such interference could be either induced by other LoRa signal or signals from other radio technologies using the same unlicensed spectrum. Therefore, the RF analysis should take this effect into consideration by an additional interference margin, or we also call it noise rise above thermal noise. So this margin is typically assessed by noise scan analysis. And note that the uplink and downlink noise rise is usually not symmetrical, since the gateways and the end devices are not located at the same elevation. Also, the uplink noise rise depends on the proximity of your gateways from neighboring cellular antennas like LTE, for example. In this graph, you can see the noise scan results showing 4 spikes representing the interference caused by an RFID transmitter around the gateway in test in the 868 MHz ISM band. Let me now briefly present you our recommended RF planning methodology and how you can leverage the different ThingPark tools to execute the different steps of this methodology. The first step is about the link budget analysis, for which we have already elaborated some details in the previous slides. The main outcome of this step is to derive the approximate cell range according to your design criteria and estimate the approximate site count to establish a bill of quantity. To realize this step, you can rely on ThingPark's air interface dimensioning tool used by Actility's customers for more than 8 years already. And then the second step is about doing detailed RF coverage predictions with a radio planning tool. This step already reuses the MAPL analysis done in step one and simulates the RF coverage of each gateway, taking into account the gateway's exact location and the antenna height, as well as the radiation patterns of the gateway antenna and the effect of the terrain topography. The outcome of this step is a coverage heat map representing your design inputs and showing potential coverage holes. You can rely on ThingPark's network coverage tool to realize this step. And once your gateways are deployed, the third step consists of doing field tests to determine the real coverage of your network and compare them with prediction heat maps provided in step two. ThingPark provides you with a network survey tool to easily analyze your work test data and visualize the different RF metrics on a user-friendly interface. Let me now quickly zoom in on each of these tools. Starting from the ThingPark Air Interface Dimensioning tool, which is an Excel-based tool developed by Actility to analyze the LoRaWAN link budgets and estimate the radio capacity of each gateway. As you can see from this diagram, the tool takes into account several pieces of inputs like the transmission power and the receiver sensitivity, the morphology-specific parameters, the regulatory limits of each country, like the maximum allowed transmission power or the maximum spinning factor or the duty cycle limitations. And it also takes into account all the design parameters, like what's your target packet error rate for both uplink and downlink, what's your maximum spinning factor, what's the maximum number of repetitions for uplink packets, and so on. And it also accounts for all the margins and gains that we have already elaborated in previous slides. In output, the tool provides the analysis about the maximum allowable pass loss, and it derives an estimation of the cell range and the intersite distance together with the appropriate area covered by each base station. Let me quickly show you how this tool looks like. So here is the ThingPark Air Interface Dimensioning tool. It's an Excel-based tool. You can see here one sheet to set all your main inputs, which are all marked in blue. And you can see among the inputs, you can set the regulatory rules together with the frequency band for your deployment. And you can set for each morphology, starting from dense urban, urban, suburban, down to rural, you can set some design parameters like what is your target uplink spinning factor at cell H, what is the target maximum packet error rate, the number of transmissions for each uplink packets, and the same thing for downlinks. And you can also set your end device location between outdoor, indoor daylight, deep indoor, or basement. And there are, you have some other metrics and some inputs that you can set here. And among your other inputs, you can also set all the end device characteristics in terms of transmission power and antenna gain, and the same thing on the gateway side. And then in the other sheet, you have the output sentences, where for each morphology, we have potentially three different link budgets, depending on the receiver slots that you intend to use for downlink for your design. So let's assume that you do that for the downlink RX2. So you have an uplink link budget and the downlink link budget based on RX2. And then the tool estimates the link budget in each direction and tells you what is the limiting link and provides you with the analysis about the maximum allowable pass loss, the cell range, the intersite distance, the site coverage area, and finally, the number of sites required to cover a target area depending on the area to be covered for each morphology. And if you want to go into the details about the detailed link budget for each morphology, so you can find them in separate sheets. And another quite interesting thing in the tool is that you have the assessment of the cell capacity. So you also have all the information regarding the uplink and downlink cell capacity analysis, depending on your input metrics, like your uplink payload size, your downlink payload size, the average number of uplink and downlink packets per day per device, the number of logical channels supported by your deployment. And accordingly, the output of the tool would be the total uplink cell capacity and the maximum device density, assuming a uniform distribution of your end devices. Let me now zoom in on ThingPark's network coverage tool, which is Actility's RF coverage prediction tool used in radio network planning for outdoor macro gateways. It's not suitable for coverage prediction of indoor gateways. This tool already embeds the link budget analysis, so it addresses both steps one and two of the methodology presented earlier. The tool also supports a large set of antenna patterns, from the most deployed antenna manufacturers in the LoRaWAN ecosystem. Additionally, the tool embeds a digital elevation model database covering the whole Earth with 30-meter resolution. And this DTM allows the tool to compute the diffraction loss caused by hilly obstacles to model the terrain shadowing effect. And finally, the tool supports two propagation models, one modeling a conservative or a safe prediction scenario, and another one modeling an optimistic prediction scenario. Let me now quickly show you how the tool looks like. So here is the ThingPark network coverage tool, which is seamlessly integrated with your ThingPark wireless or your ThingPark enterprise account. So you can see here, I have already prepared two simulations, one for outdoor simulation, and I have set a given set of device settings and regulatory settings and link budget settings, like for example, two transmissions. And here it's for outdoor simulation. I can show you with the location of devices assumed to be outdoor. You can see this is the expectation of the tool regarding the coverage. And if I do the same thing from exactly the same parameters, but just replacing outdoor simulation with indoor daylight device location, so you can see that the tool predicts a different coverage. Of course, the coverage is shrinked with respect to what we had with the outdoor simulation. And that's why the tool can be used to help you analyze several deployment scenarios. And you can play with the design assumptions and with the device location in order to predict the coverage of each specific case. And if you want to set a new simulation, to add a new simulation, so you go here and you follow the different steps, starting by setting the prediction type of your simulation, whether it's safe or optimistic prediction, which will dictate the appropriate propagation model for each scenario. And then you can set your simulation settings from the device and the regulatory settings. And then you can set, if necessary, you can change the default settings of your link budget settings by setting your uplink and downlink noise rise or the maximum spending factor or the number of repetitions. And then you can prepare the list of your base stations. Either you can do a greenfield assessment for new gateways not yet included into your ThingPark account, or you can reuse gateways from your ThingPark account by exporting the list of existing base stations already retrieved under your ThingPark account. And once you are ready, you just import your CSV file, and then you are done. And if you want to do pure link budget analysis, so you can rely on the Swagger interface so that you can access this link budget API and do your link budget assessment in a way that is very similar to the AIR interface dimensioning tool that was just described before. Now, let me talk to you quickly about the network survey tool. So the ThingPark network survey tool is a field test analysis tool helping to assess the RF coverage with real devices and gateways. It offers a rich set of RF metrics, such as the packet loss analysis, representing coverage holes on the map by gray dots, the uplink and downlink SNR, RSSI, and estimated signal power, and an estimation also of the uplink and downlink interference levels along the walk test, and also an assessment of the network geolocation precision by comparing the coordinates generated by the ThingPark location solver with the real GPS coordinates reported by the device in its payload. And finally, the ThingPark spectrum analysis is another member of the family of network tools. This tool helps you easily estimate the noise level of your frequency band and choose the best frequencies for your deployment by avoiding noisy channels. The spectrum analysis tool is seamlessly integrated with your ThingPark gateway management portal. Therefore, you can easily launch your noise scan campaign from your gateway management portal and then view the results in the spectrum analysis tool. Not only you can analyze the scan results of individual gateways, but the tool also allows you to do time and spatial aggregation of individual scan results over a given group of gateways. Such aggregation is indeed very useful to provide you statistically relevant insight about the interference level of a given geographical zone, since the RF channel planning is generally consistent across a full zone, not personalized specifically and separately for each gateway. And now, if you want to leverage these ThingPark network tools integrated with the ThingPark Enterprise product, sign up for free to our ThingPark community platform. You will then have access to the ThingPark Enterprise alongside the ThingPark network coverage, the network survey, and the spectrum analysis tools. Contact Actility if you want to buy credit on ThingPark network coverage, or buy training services, or even upgrade from the ThingPark community version to the fully supported ThingPark Enterprise SaaS or self-hosted. Thank you for your attention.